many mass extinctions throughout Earth's history, but the one that gets the most attention is, of course, the one involving dinosaurs and an asteroid. But today, I'm going to be talking about the Ordovician mass extinction event. The end Ordovician, or late Ordovician, or Ordovician Silurian mass extinction event is the first of the big five mass extinction events that are recognized to be the largest five mass extinctions throughout the Phanerozoic eon, aka from around 550 million years ago to today. And this end Ordovician extinction event coincides with two major oxygen and carbon isotope excursions that represent two pulses of climate change that likely caused the extinctions. The first pulse was a cooling event that caused major glaciation and regression, or sea level fall, which led to the extinction of warm-adapted species, as well as species that were living in epicontinental seas or shallow continental seas that had transgressed onto continents during time of sea level rise or high sea level. And so this regression caused just as many extinctions as the cooling did, or the glaciation, to the warm-adapted species. In fact, this image to the bottom right is actually a depiction of what the dried up epicontinental seas would have looked like, with all sorts of dead trilobites and crinoids that would have been really thriving in those environments at the time. The second pulse of climate change was a warming event that ended. Sorry about my cat. It was a warming event that ended this ice age, and this caused devastation among the cool adapted species that had just survived the first pulse of extinctions. The initial cooling event, the first pulse of climate change, came on really suddenly, as we can see with this really sharp peak at the time of this event. And the cause of this is a mystery still, but we have some ideas. For example, we think that a sudden change in the global greenhouse effect was likely the cause for the initial cooling, because this is one of the few processes that can take effect and cause global change on such a short timescale like this cooling event happened in. However, what initially caused the change in the greenhouse effect is still uncertain, but we have a lot of ideas. For example, this cooling event coincides with the spread of non-vascular plants on land. If you haven't seen my When Life Moved to Land video, I talk in that video about what types of organisms first colonized land and the spread of non-vascular and then eventually vascular plants throughout land and then eventually animals, etc. And how before the Ordovician period, when non-vascular plants spread over land, the land was mainly barren rock, and the only living things to have spread to land before these non-vascular plants were likely just bacteria and fungi. So it was pretty barren, and the spread of plants onto land was a major change in the biosphere, and then that affected climate, because the spread of plants over land would have accelerated weathering rates, and weathering of rocks, or the breakdown of rocks and transport of nutrients to the ocean and increase in primary productivity, would have decreased atmospheric CO2 concentrations, aka changing or decreasing global greenhouse effect, and therefore triggering a cooling or glaciation event. And if you want to know more about how mineral weathering contributes to cooling, you can check out my mineral weathering or microbial weathering video. I'll link it up here to the top right if you want to check that out. But it turns out that during this time, during the Ordovician and these extinction events, weathering and subsequent carbon sequestration and burial was being enhanced by many factors, not just the plants spreading on land. For example, Gondwana, a large supercontinent during the time, moved over the South Pole and caused ice caps to form, which decreased sea level and exposed land to more weathering. The tectonic orogeny, which I will be talking about in an upcoming early Paleozoic geology video, or it might be before this one, I don't know. I'm pre-filming very early, so it might be out by now. If so, I'll link it up to the top right. But the tectonic orogeny was a mountain building event that also contributed to weathering during this time. And then elevated basalt eruption rates, according to the strontium ratios at the time, would have also contributed to enhanced weathering, because basalt is relatively weatherable. And movement of continents through the intertropical convergence zone, which is a zone where rainfall is greatly increased, would have also increased rainfall, which would have increased chemical weathering as well. And of course, lastly, is the spread of non-vascular plants over land. But how exactly do these plants increase weathering rates? Well, all plants require nutrients like phosphorus, potassium, calcium, magnesium, and iron, and they can accelerate the release of these nutrients from rocks by excreting organic acids. Vascular plants enhance silicate weathering by factors of 2 to 10 in the case for calcium. And the spread of vascular plants throughout the Devonian period is thought to have decreased atmospheric CO2 at the end of the Devonian and have led to the glaciation and mass extinction that was the Devonian mass extinction event, which is the second of the big five mass extinctions throughout the Phanerozoic. And I'll talk about the Devonian mass extinction event and how these vascular plants might have contributed to that in the Devonian mass extinction video. But less attention has been given to how non-vascular plants affected the Ordovician mass extinction event before the Devonian. Although the fossil record of plant spores indicate that non-vascular plants were growing on land by the mid to late Ordovician, non-vascular plants are often assumed to have negligible effects on weathering because they lack roots. However, this 2012 paper, which I'll link in my description for your reference, set out to determine the effect of non-vascular plants on weathering. And they found that weathering rates were increased by factors of 1.5 to 2.5 for potassium, 1.4 to 3.6 for calcium, 1.5 to 5.4 for magnesium, and 170 to 360 for iron. So overall, plants, even non-vascular ones like mosses, can have a significant effect on weathering and greatly enhance it, therefore contributing to the subsequent carbon sequestration and burial that comes as a result of weathering. However, the cooling and the sea level drop that happened due to the decrease in carbon in the atmosphere was not the only thing that contributed to the extinctions during this time, or so we think. So the first pulse of extinctions correlated with a positive sulfur isotope excursion in pyrite, and sulfur 32, the light isotope or denominator in this ratio, could have been used up by extensive deep sea pyrite deposition. And this could represent really sulfide-rich and oxygen-lacking conditions called euxinic conditions or euxinia, because these conditions would have had to be widespread to produce enough pyrite to create this shift in the sulfur isotope ratio that we see in the pyrite rock record. And the resulting euxinia or anoxia or just lack of oxygen and increase in sulfide would have been toxic to a lot of the animals that needed oxygen and didn't like sulfide. And so a lot of the oxygen breathing benthic animals would have died out because of this. Therefore, this would have contributed heavily to the extinctions at the time. But do we know what caused the anoxia and euxinia during this time? Well, like I mentioned, increased weathering rates would have increased nutrient flux to seawater or phosphorus flux, which is a major nutrient, and that would have enhanced primary productivity, which would have led to eutrophication or blooms of primary producers that would have led to deep water anoxia and euxinia because bacterial decomposition of the algal bloom uses up all the oxygen, and then below that, everything dies that needs oxygen, and other things that don't need oxygen thrive, and many of those things produce sulfide that's then more toxic to the oxygen-liking things, and it's just a whole thing. And these conditions would be consistent with the types of extinctions that happened during this pulse. For example, deep water benthic fauna were heavily affected, and planktonic fauna were also hit hard because the steepened chemocline or the decrease in the oxygen-rich habitable zone would have restricted those fauna. And this primary productivity increase is also recorded in organic carbon isotopes in the rock record. However, more data actually supports well-oxygenated conditions than anoxic conditions during this cooling pulse. And this is mainly in the fact that black shales, which are indicative of anoxic conditions, are rare during this time, and where they are found represent more local anoxic conditions rather than global anoxia and widespread extinctions due to oxygen limitation. So how can we explain away the sulfur isotope excursion without anoxic conditions? Well, this excursion is actually not recorded in carbonate-associated sulfates, just in pyrite. And so seawater probably did not experience a general light sulfur isotope depletion during this glaciation. Instead, cooling likely lowered the metabolism of aerobes or aerobic bacteria that therefore increased the organic matter available for anaerobic bacteria, like sulfate-reducing bacteria, below where the aerobes, you know, eat the organic matter. So basically, enough organic matter got past the aerobic bacteria to provide the anaerobic sulfate-reducing bacteria with lots of organic matter. And why is this important? Well, sulfate-reducing bacteria take up more light sulfur than they do heavy, and that could account for the sulfur isotope excursion without having to invoke marine anoxia. Although we lean toward an oxic condition scenario for the cooling event or the first pulse of climate change during the Ordovician extinctions, we actually have solid evidence for ocean anoxia during the second pulse of climate change and extinctions during this end Ordovician event. During the second pulse, there is a huge increase in the abundance of black shales deposited in anoxic conditions, and the widespread distribution of anoxia during this time and black shale deposition is called the Hernantian Ocean Anoxic Event, or HOAE, and other redox-sensitive elements or oxygen-sensitive elements also record this anoxic event from isotope excursions of elements such as molybdenum, uranium, and neodymium. However, the cause of the HOAE, as is a common theme today, is not fully certain, but we think that an increased nutrient supply enhanced blooms that depleted oxygen levels in the seawater. Just like we talked about earlier, enhanced nutrient supply from enhanced weathering would have done this. But why might it have waited until after the first extinction pulse? Well, cyanobacterial mats and blooms are likely the cause for this second pulse of anoxia. And that's for a couple of reasons. One is that they thrived after the initial extinction event due to the lack of grazers and competitors that had gone extinct during the extinction event. And this resurgence of cyanobacterial mats and blooms was also enhanced by the fact that they have an advantage over other bloom-forming algae when it comes to nitrogen. What do I mean by this? Well, nitrogen isotopic measurements during this event record high rates of denitrification, which is a process that depletes or decreases nitrate or biologically usable nitrogen. However, for cyanobacteria, this would not have been a problem because they have the ability to fix nitrogen or convert it to nitrate, and therefore they have an advantage over eukaryotic algae that don't have this ability. But it's not just the lack of grazers and competitors and the advantage of nitrogen fixation that cyanobacteria have over eukaryotic algae that contributed to these blooms during the time. It was also enhanced upwelling due to freshwater mixing from melting glaciers after the cooling pulse, the first pulse of climate change during these extinction events, that then provided nutrients to the surface waters, because upwelling is just basically when nutrient-rich bottom waters are upwelled to surface waters, providing planktonic blooms like cyanobacterial blooms with a bunch of nutrients, and therefore they become increased and increased and increased, and they cause, you know, more anoxia and euxinia below them. So this upwelling during glacial retreat after the first pulse of climate change, during the second pulse of climate change, as well as these other factors, led to enhanced primary productivity and widespread anoxia and euxinia in the bottom waters of the ocean. And so to summarize these two major pulses of climate change and extinctions during the Ordovician, we have the first pulse of cooling that started with Gondwana moving over the South Pole and ice caps forming, basalt eruptions increasing, rainfall over the continents in the intertropical convergence zone The tachonic orogeny, increasing weathering, and non-vascular plants also enhancing weathering and subsequent carbon burial, and the Gondwana over the South Pole doing so indirectly, but also contributing to the enhanced weathering and carbon burial, and the drawdown of carbon dioxide due to this enhanced nutrient flux to the ocean and carbon sequestration from primary productivity, as well as carbon burial. And more glaciation was caused by the decrease in CO2 because that decreased greenhouse effect. And that glaciation and cooling, as well as sea level drop, caused mass extinction to many warm adapted and epicontinental sea dwelling species. And then the second pulse or warming event during this time was marked by an increase in cyanobacteria due to those extinctions that wiped out a lot of the things that eat those cyanobacteria. And they led to Anoxia and Yixinia that caused the major mass extinctions in the second pulse of warming. And the quick spread of non-vascular plants likely also exhausted their nutrient supply to the point where weathering slowed down a bit, allowing an increase in atmospheric CO2 and therefore warming to happen after this cooling event and glacial retreat, which also contributed to upwelling that provided surface blooms with more nutrients and therefore increased Anoxia and Yixinia and therefore mass extinctions of oxygen-liking organisms below those blooms. If you want to know more about how vascular plants later on in the Devonian caused mass extinctions during that period, you can check out my Devonian mass extinction video. If it's out yet, I'll put it up here on the screen for you. And you can also check out my major reference in the description below. It is called Earth System History. And I also will link all the papers I used to make this video in the description below as well if you want to check those out. And if you want to ever see extra content or more behind the scenes of my own research and things like that, you can join as a channel member below and support the channel that way, as well as get extra content. And I greatly, greatly appreciate that. And if you have joined, thank you so much. And if you cannot join, I totally understand. You can still press that like button and I'd really, really appreciate it. So thank you guys again so much for watching, and I can't wait to see you next time. Bye.